I talk a lot about flow metrics on this channel, but I'm often asked, how do we start? What's the first thing we should do? Well, it's easy, so let's get started. Now, the cornerstone of flow metrics is cycle time. Now, if you haven't heard of Peter Drucker, you really should have. He's widely regarded as the father of management and created many ways of doing things in the workplace that we now take for granted. He consulted for IBM, General Electric, Procter & Gamble, and Intel. He foresaw the information age and coined the phrase knowledge worker. He's often quoted as saying, "You can't manage what you can't measure." Now, to manage the flow of work, we need to measure the parts that make up the end product. And that's where cycle time can help. If you don't already know, cycle time is the time it takes you from when you start a story to when it's done. So, you need to decide the starting point in your workflow and the end point. Now, I usually measure it from in progress to done. Now, if you're thinking, hey, we do Scrum, so flow metrics don't fit into our process, think again. They are just as valid in Scrum as story points, velocity, and burn down charts, none of which are part of Scrum or the Scrum Guide. Now, this is a Scrum board. You'll notice that to do is part of the sprint. Now, when an item is taken into sprint at sprint planning, it's placed into the to do column. This is because it's queued ready to start, but we haven't actually started it yet. Now, if we measured from to do to done, all the stories would end up having very similar cycle times. Certainly their start date would be the same, and that isn't very helpful. Now, we don't start all the stories in sprint at the same time, and this is why we have a to-do column, but don't use it as our starting point for our cycle time. Now, your workflow will probably vary, but base it on this concept. And in case you're wondering, yes, cycle time will include any time story spends in blocked or on hold. If you base your cycle time on when a story first lands in your backlog to when it's eventually done, this is not cycle time, it's called lead time. Now, lead time is also a very important metric. It tells you how long it takes to get a story done from when it's first asked for. But I wouldn't recommend starting with this, as you can end up tying yourself in knots and getting nowhere. In my opinion, this is best looked at after you've got cycle time under control. So, why cycle time? Well, firstly, because it's solely related to the team, and that makes it quicker and easier because it's based on what the team does day in, day out. And lead time starts earlier than this and involves more players than just the team, so it's more difficult to address initially. And secondly, it helps us understand our throughput and predictability, which then helps us find issues in our process that we can improve upon. Now, no matter what tool you're using, it will track the time it takes to get a story from one status to the next, often called a transition, in the background. Now, the fun starts when you try to extract this data. Now, most tools don't allow you to do this natively, which is extremely irritating. Now, with Jira, you'll need an Atlassian Marketplace plugin to do this, such as EasyBI or Timing Status. Now, I've done a separate video on how to do this in EasyBI. EasyBI is my preferred method because you can do a lot with it. Now, check that out here. But I'll quickly show you how to do this in Timing Status by RVS. So, you'll first need to purchase Timing Status by RVS from the Atlassian Marketplace and get your Jira admin to install it. It's licensed per Jira seat, and you can see the current pricing here for 1,000 users. Once installed, you'll find it here under Apps. Now, Timing Status does lots of different things, which I'm not going to go into here, but we're specifically interested in cycle time between our designated start and end date in our workflow, which in this example is in progress and done. So, to do this in Timing Status, select Status Transition Dates from the dropdown. You can narrow this down further by selecting one or more of the filters at the top, such as Project, Team, Sprint, Date Range, etc. And there you have it, the dates that your stories transition to each status. Now, if you're getting any value from this, please hit the like button and subscribe. That stuff really makes a difference and I would greatly appreciate it. Now, simply download this to a CSV file and import it into Excel, which I will show you in a moment. Now, for other tools such as Microsoft ADO, you'll need to use Power BI to extract the data. But if you're lucky enough to be using Kanbanize, you should be able to get this through the interface. Now, when you extract the data, you'll most likely end up with a CSV file. So just import that into Excel or equivalent, and it will look something like this. The only two columns we need are the dates our stories entered in progress and done, because they are the statuses we're using in our workflow for our start and end date in our cycle time. So you can delete the other columns. And this is all you need to calculate cycle time. You simply subtract the date from the done column from the date in the in progress column and add one day. You add one day because we want to count every day which the item was worked on as part of the total. For example, When an item starts and ends on the same day, we would never say that the story took zero time to complete. So we add one, effectively rounding the partial day to a full day. So what about stories that don't start and end on the same day? For example, let's say a story starts on the 1st of January and finishes on the 2nd of January. By using this calculation, the cycle time would be 2 days, and I think this is a reasonable and a realistic outcome. Now, you can do this easily with the Excel function network days, which automatically excludes weekends. Network days accepts 3 arguments: a start date, an end date, plus an optional list of exclusion dates that you specify. And these could be, for example, bank holidays. So you can see in this example, I have a list of all UK bank holidays in 2024. I simply select that range as argument 3 and they will be excluded from the calculation. But I wouldn't remove people's annual leave, as this is a normal thing to happen and will even itself out during the year. But you could, if you really wanted to, simply by adding those dates to the date exclusion list. So your calculation would look like this. Now, simply copy that formula all the way down your list. Now, this shows you your cycle time for every individual completed story. And this is great information to have in itself, but we can go one step further to make this data incredibly useful. You could take an average of all of our completed story cycle times, but averages are notoriously bad. Now check this book out by Sam Savage, The Flaw of Averages, find out why. Instead, what we want to do is find out what a high probability of completing any of our stories is. So we can take the 85th percentile of all our previously completed stories. Now to do this, we just use Excel's percentile function, which you can see here. Now, the data here is looking pretty good, but this is just from my home simulation. I would expect your data to look very different. So, if your 85th percentile is telling you that it took 10 days to complete any of your stories with an 85% chance of it happening, do you think that's good or bad? Well, if you're doing Scrum and 2-week sprints, this is telling you that you would need to start all your stories pretty much as soon as you start the sprint to have a high probability of completing them, which isn't great. So, it gives you insight into possible actions you might need to consider, such as perhaps your stories are generally too big or too complex, or perhaps they haven't been well defined and you're hitting many blockers during the sprint, or maybe you're taking too much work into the sprint. In my experience, a good 85th percentile of all your completed stories to aim for is 5 days or less if you're doing 2-week sprints. Now, the great thing about using percentiles is that it does not matter how big or small or how complex a story is. It simply doesn't matter, so dwell on that for a moment. You can choose whatever probability you like, but 85% is my favorite because it gives a good balance. Now for me, this is far more powerful than using story points of velocity, which is based on educated guesses. And let's not forget, developers hate estimating how long something will take to get done. So this approach removes all of that and makes everyone's life easier. Now that doesn't mean you don't need to discuss the work. Of course you still need to do this. It just removes the rubbish part of saying something will take 5 story points, which has no value. Now using cycle time in the 85th percentile takes out all the guesswork, because it's based on fact. So, this is your starting point for flow metrics. Now get your cycle time under control, and then you can move on to analyze other things such as flow efficiency, work item age, and for me, the big game changer, Monte Carlo simulation. I've done a number of videos on all of these, which I'll put links to in the description below. And Monte Carlo simulation allows you to forecast either how long it will take to get X number of stories done, or by what date X number of stories will be completed. And we can use our 85th percentile here as well with Monte Carlo. And this means we can forecast with a high degree of certainty when we can get a feature or a project completed. And this isn't guesswork, this is based on what has actually happened. And in my experience, leadership and stakeholders far prefer this, as it's something they can actually get their head around and understand. Plus, teams like it because it means they can stop wasting time with story points. Now, the data that you've already collected for cycle time is all the data you're going to need to forecast with Monte Carlo. You just need to know your throughput, so how many stories were completed on what date, which you already have. I've done 2 Monte Carlo simulation videos, each with a free Excel template to allow you to run it. Both videos are in the description below, so check them out. But I'm going to be doing a big update on Monte Carlo simulation in a month or two, so stay tuned for that because you won't want to miss it. For now, check this video out for a great overview of flow metrics. And don't forget to hit the like button, share and subscribe. That stuff really makes a difference and I'd greatly appreciate it. Okay, that's it for this one. Stay safe, stay humble, and I will see you next Thursday for another Agile Thought.